If you're not an artist, which I certainly am not, then you might get a bit spooked and confused hearing words like normal maps, anti-aliasing, PBR, specularity and so on. Making 2D games look good is hard enough, but adding a third dimension introduces a whole nother level of complexity. So in this video, I'm going to break that complexity down and explain the most fundamental parts about working with 3D graphics in a game engine. I'm going to be using Unity, but these concepts are relevant for any 3D engine. So the first thing you need for a 3D game is a 3D model. Where 2D games use sprites that are made up of individual pixels, 3D games use models that are made up of individual polygons. And just like how pixels are simple coloured boxes that when combined can produce beautifully detailed multicoloured pictures, we can combine polygons, which are just flat 2D shapes with straight edges, to create wonderfully detailed objects in three-dimensional space. These models are created in software like Blender or Maya, where you can manipulate and combine simple shapes to create anything you want. The most important thing you as a game developer need to know is the concept of a model's poly count. Since all 3D models are just made up of lots of 2D polygons, or polys for short, a choice needs to be made about the number of polys to use when creating the 3D model. The choice impacts how the 3D artist will create the model, but you ultimately need to make the choice because it will impact your game's performance. The polys that make up a model are just shapes with straight sides, so creating an object that has straight sides, like a box, does not require many polys. But the smoother and more detailed you want a model to be, the more polys you'll need. Because to generate this smooth shape, we are just linking lots of smaller, straight-sided shapes. A model's performance cost is measured using poly count, though you will also hear people say triangles or tries instead of polys, along with mentioning vertex count. All of this relates to the same core idea that the more detailed your model is, the more vertices or geometry it will need, and the more effort it will take for your computer to render this model. So when deciding on the poly count of your models, you need to keep in mind the trade-off between the level of detail and the performance cost that detail will have on your game. If you want realistic graphics, you'll be targeting high-end platforms that can handle the added performance cost. If you want the game to be available on lower-end platforms, then you will need to ensure that you do not have models with excessive poly counts. Once we have a model created, we can import it into our game engine, but it will be a boring whitish grey colour. The role of texturing is to give colour and life to this model so that it doesn't look so bland. To do this, we need to control how the model is rendered, and we use materials to do this. Creating a material, you will see lots of different properties like albedo, metallic, occlusion, and so on. 3D games these days tend to use the physically based rendering, or PBR, paradigm. It's essentially a way of rendering objects so that they react to light in a natural and realistic way. Because lighting controls how we perceive the world, the way objects react to light will control how they appear. And we control how our object is displayed in-game by using different maps that each contain information about how the material is rendered. The most common maps you'll come across are diffuse, metallic, smoothness, roughness, glossiness, normal maps, and ambient occlusion. These are all textures that we use to, well, texture our model. Textures are usually sized in powers of 2, with smaller textures being 512 by 512 and bigger textures reaching 2048 by 2048. Bigger texture files obviously have higher resolutions, but naturally take up more space, so this trade-off is something you'll need to keep in mind. Our first texture is the diffuse map, which contains information about what colour and pattern the model should have. You could literally take a picture of something IRL and use that as your diffuse map, and it would be like sticking that picture to the face of your object. You'll see in our material we add this map to the albedo property. Albedo, or base color, is just the PBR version of a color texture, while diffuse is the non-PBR version. People will often use the terms albedo and diffuse maps interchangeably since they're very similar, with both maps responsible for giving us the color texture information. The main difference is that albedo textures don't provide any light or shadow information, while diffuse maps do. And this is because in the PBR workflow we rely on other maps to give us this lighting information. Now, one quick thing to note about these texture maps is that if you look at the raw image, you'll sometimes see some crazy looking shapes and patterns that look nothing like the model. You don't need to know too much about these if you're not making the textures yourself, but part of the modeling process involves what's called UV mapping. UVs are 2D texture coordinates that govern how the texture image will be applied to the model's surface. So as long as the UVs are set up correctly, the image texture will appear correctly on the surface mesh, regardless of how wacky the actual image of the texture looks. Anyway, the next map is a metallic map, and this is just what it sounds like. It's a texture that controls how metallic looking certain parts of the model will be. What's interesting about this map is that unlike a diffuse map, metallic maps are grayscale. Instead of giving red, blue, and green values that indicate what color the material should be, grayscale images can only use black, white, or anything in between, which is basically just gray. And these grayscale images essentially just correspond to a value between 0 and 1, or 0 to 100, depending on what scale you're using. Pure black means 0, and pure white means 1. And in the case of our metallic map, we use this notion of black and white to define the level of metallicness. So if we have an image that is completely black, we're basically saying to the computer, this object's surface has absolutely no metal, essentially giving it a value of 0. Conversely, a pure white image indicates that the surface is completely metallic or a value of 1. If we want some level of metallicness, we use different shades of grey, which will correspond to a value between 0 and 1. What's amazing about this is that we can define specific parts of our object as being metallic by having that part of the texture darker, and define other parts of the object as being non-metallic by setting that part of the texture to something lighter. This is an incredibly powerful way of giving added realism to your object by determining how each part of it reacts to light. The same grayscale method is also used for roughness maps. Roughness, smoothness, glossiness, they all refer to the same thing, which is how rough or glossy the object should be when exposed to light. They're essentially opposite ends of the same spectrum, where an object which has zero roughness has 100% smooth or glossiness, while 100% roughness means zero smoothness. The grayscale map for this texture has white corresponding to complete roughness, while black is completely smooth or glossy. You'll see in Unity that we don't have anywhere to put our roughness or smoothness map, but instead a slider for smoothness and a source dropdown. Everything you see on this material, the albedo, the smoothness slider, the stuff down here, all of that is controlled by the shader. In fact, materials in Unity are essentially just interface representations of a shader. You can see up here that next to the shader it says standard. I'm not going to go into shaders here, but keep in mind that every material and therefore the look of every object's surface will be based off a shader. And by customizing the shader, we can customize what maps our material uses and how those texture maps are used. For the standard shader, it's been written so that it doesn't use a dedicated roughness map, but instead sources the information about roughness from either the albedo alpha or the metallic alpha. If you're going to use the standard shader, you need to pack the roughness information into the alpha channel of one of these textures and set that as the source. Alternatively, you can write your own shader and include a property for the roughness map. I appreciate shaders can appear somewhat mysterious, and along with Unity deciding to use smoothness, which if you remember is just the inverse of roughness, it can be pretty confusing. However, even if you don't include a roughness map, you can still set the roughness of the object by playing around with this slider. Since your albedo texture will likely be completely opaque, i.e. not transparent, you can use this as your source and set the smoothness to 1 if you want the material to be very glossy, or 0 if you don't want it reflecting any light. Okay, next up we have the normal map, which is by far the most funky looking texture. This weird purpley image is used to fake depth and detail on our object. You often want to use normal maps because it reduces the need to model bumps or dents into the actual geometry of the model, thus saving us precious polygons and reducing the model's performance cost. Again, you don't need to know the ins and outs of normal maps if you're not making them yourself, but the reason they look so weird is because the map uses red, green, and blue channels to calculate the three dimensions. You might hear some people talk about bump maps, which are similar to normal maps, but are grayscale instead of RGB. They contain less information than normal maps, and so are less widely used. You'll see a slot for a height map here, which is similar to normal maps as they add depth to the texture, but unlike normal maps, height maps affect the mesh and will increase your object's poly count. I would focus on normal maps for now and look into height maps if you ever need the added detail. Finally, we have the occlusion slot, which is for our ambient occlusion or AO texture map. This is another map focused on adding more detail and making your object look more realistic. This map is used to calculate how much indirect light an object should receive and leads to those subtle shadows seen between two touching objects. Ambient occlusion is subtle but greatly contributes to the overall look and feel of your object, so for most models you should include it, as this kind of ambient occlusion doesn't have a big performance cost. So those are the most important texture maps you need to know when working with materials on your 3D model. To recap, diffuse and albedo maps are responsible for defining the texture and color of your model. Metallic maps control how metallic the surface of your object looks. Roughness maps define the reflectivity of your object. Normal maps simulate the lighting on bumps and dents, while ambient occlusion adds detail to the shadows your object would generate. UV mapping dictates how the image textures appear on your 3D model, while shaders control what information your material uses and how it uses it. The final part of 3D graphics I want to touch on is lighting. Lighting is one of the most overlooked aspects of 3D games. Done well, good lighting amplifies the look of your game and makes everything come together and look so much better. Done poorly, and even the best looking models in the world will look like absolute trash in your game. The tricky thing about lighting is that firstly, it isn't immediately obvious how best to light a scene. A lot of the way you light a scene depends on what kind of emotion you want the player to experience and the points you want to draw attention to. And secondly, lighting often has big performance implications. Real-time lighting and shadows can obliterate your game's performance, and many games, even today, will often fake shadows because of how expensive they are to calculate in real time. I've mentioned how certain textures control how light affects the appearance of your object's material, but I suggest you play around with the lighting options available to you in-engine and see how your objects react. There's plenty to learn about how to use baked versus real-time lighting, as well as probes to manage performance in games. Familiarize yourself with what's out there and then play around with it so you can see what impact it has on your models. Hopefully this has been helpful, and good luck with your 3D game.